if you take nothing else away from this video, please don't use Turkish 8mm in a semi-automatic or fully automatic firearm. Thanks for tuning in to another video on ForgottenWeapons.com. I'm Ian McCollum, and of course today we are taking a look at Turkish 8mm Mauser ammunition. This specifically is 1941 dated ammunition, and there's a variety of ammo that came out of Turkey as surplus, a variety of dates, and a variety of conditions to it. So some of it is heavy ball, some of it is light ball, different bullet weights. Some of it has a reputation for having loose or cracked necks. Some of it has a reputation for being fairly good. All of it has a reputation for being very hot. So what I said at the very beginning there, don't use this in semi or fully automatic firearms, I mean very, very deliberately. I know of probably half a dozen machine guns that have been destroyed with various types of Turkish 8mm Mauser ammunition, and I have a friend who is missing 2.5 fingers from Turkish 8mm Mauser ammunition. So today we're going to take a look at this specific batch, see what we get on a chronograph, and then talk about what it is and why it is. So let's actually just take this straight out to the range. Before anyone asks, I'm not worried about losing fingers. I will be shooting this in a Kar98k, model of 1898 Mauser bolt-action rifle, which should be quite safely capable of handling whatever pressure we can get out of this ammunition.
We've actually got the original bandolier here. Run this on stripper clips, 15 rounds. .29-21 .29-31 .29-68 .29-22 .29-54 Stripper clip. I can get it out of the bandolier. These bandoliers are kind of awful. Right. 29.75. 29.75. 29.51 29.77 29.47 And one more clip. 29.76 29.05 29.46 29.33 29.37. No hang fires. Recoil was harsher than I was expecting, and I think I have actually opened up a crack in the wrist of the rifle.
Alas, my poor rifle did not survive this test unscathed. We'll take a look at this in a moment. But first, let me give you a little bit of detail about what this cartridge is. It really is pretty much a copy of the German S cartridge. When the Germans everyone at some point went from round-nosed bullets to pointed bullets, and when the Germans did this with 8mm Mauser, what they came up with was a bullet of a little over 150 grains, traveling at about 2,850 feet per second, 870 meters per second, a 9.8 gram bullet. and that would be their initial development. They would also then later go on to develop a heavy ball, which was better for machine guns. That heavy ball would be their primary cartridge in World War II. That is more like 196, 198 grains, but traveling slower, 24, 2500 feet per second in that range. So what the Turks have made here is a copy of the initial cartridge, the light bullet traveling faster. And this is because Turkey at this time was very much influenced by Germany. Their military had a lot of German advisors, German technical aid. And in fact, what we see here is a lot of very similar to German equipment as well. The idea of packaging it in these bandoliers on the stripper clips, the look of the cupronickel jacket on the bullets. This all looks very much like German. It's a German flake powder in there, which you'll see in a minute. So that's where they were coming from. The big problem is this ammunition did not store all that well, and it has gotten overpressure as a result. So let's take a closer look at this ammunition taken apart, and we'll talk about the chronograph results and some of what the cases look like. This ammo was originally packaged in 1,400 round wooden crates, the same as Germany's packaging standards, and then each of these bandoliers has 7 pockets to it. Each pocket holds 2 stripper clips, so 70 rounds per bandolier. I don't have the crate, I apologize. These bandoliers do vary in color, but you can usually recognize them by the really, really kind of cheap style of little buttons. These are disposable. The cloth is thin, the buttons are flimsy. They're one-use sorts of deals. Not all ammo in bandoliers is Turkish, but right now the vast majority of what you actually find out there will be. This particular batch is nice and clean. We can pull this off here. All the head stamps are the same. And what we have, orient it this way, what we have up on the very top at 12 o'clock is TC with a star and crescent, and that is an abbreviation for Turkish Republic. FS on the bottom is the factory code. We have 7.9 on the left side. That's the caliber, 8mm. And we have a 4-digit date stamp, 1941, over there on the right. Like I said, dates vary on this. The Turks adopted 8mm in like 1928. Ammunition does exist dating back to the 1930s. Most of what you see imported is going to be between in the 1940s, from 41 here through 49. Looking at some pulled bullets, we have a flat base style of construction. This is just exactly what the German S bullet was designed to look like. There is a little bit of a waist right at the base of the bullet. That is for crimping the case neck into. If we take a look at actual bullet weights, an average of a sample of 10 here came out to 154.3 grains with standard deviation of just 0.66 grains. So really a very consistent bullet weight. As usual, I don't have any good way to assess accuracy with this. Factors like bullet concentricity. So I don't know about those. The cartridge case is made of brass. The bullet does pull a magnet. That's relevant to some people for some shooting ranges. And this is Berdan primed ammunition, and it is absolutely, definitely corrosive ammunition. So if you do use this, make sure to clean with some sort of water-containing cleaning solution. Soap and water, very hot water, those work very nicely to clean the corrosive salts out that are the result of corrosive primers. The powder used in this is a flake type powder. This also makes sense in that it is the same sort that the Germans used. That's what they would have advised and helped provide to Turkey. All right, now let's get to the important part, which is chronograph, velocity, pressure, etc. I fired a total of 15 rounds over the chronograph. Our average velocity was 2,948 feet per second with a standard deviation of 22.94. So that's not particularly, well, that's actually almost identical to the Ethiopian 8mm ammunition that we did some chronographing of. It's not particularly good. This would not be considered acceptably consistent by modern factory standards. More important than this, however, is what that velocity actually is. This is supposed to be a copy of the German S cartridge. It is about 100 feet per second faster than the German S cartridge was from the best documentation I've been able to find, which is, by the way, Dieter Stort's book on the Mauser 98. And if we look at the case heads, you will see what is called cratering there, where material has come back up around the firing pin to create what is, in effect, a little crater style of thing, where this actually protrudes up above the surface of the primer. And that is an indication of overly high pressure. Now, there are going to be some people who will retort that this is sometimes just the result of, you know, poor fit of the firing pin in the firing pin hole of the bolt face. However, what I will do here, though, is compare the right cartridges to the left ones. These left-hand cartridges are Romanian 8mm Mauser, which is substantially lower velocity, lower pressure. This is proper good ammunition, fired out of the exact same rifle. So you can see that we have a nice, deep, clean firing pin impression on the Romanian, where this Turkish, again, the exact same rifle, has much shallower imprints with cratering. This is a sign of overpressure. Another sign of overpressure is the rifle breaking. So felt recoil was pretty hefty on this, and I have actually now developed a crack in the back of, well, in the wrist of the stock right here, as well as right behind the receiver tang. So I don't know, you can see the crack there. I discovered this because it is actually, you can feel it running your finger over that crack. It is that the top section here is lifting up over the bottom section. And I noticed that during the firing of those 15 test rounds. So between the cratering, the excessive velocity on the chronograph, and it breaking my rifle, I am quite happy to go on the record as calling this stuff overpressure ammunition. I want to point out that pressure and velocity are not perfectly related in the way some people may expect that they are. An increase in pressure does not necessarily translate exactly into a proportional increase in velocity. So when we look at this and say, oh, this is only 100 feet per second faster than what the proper German ammunition that it's copying was, that doesn't mean that the pressure is only that same small amount over what it ought to be. This is a case where the pressure, because of poor storage over time, the pressure is increased more than the velocity has. So you can't look at this and judge it entirely by its velocity. You have to also take into account factors like the primer cratering. People are going to ask if I was putting myself in danger doing this, and the answer is no, I really wasn't, because I am shooting this in a Mauser 98 bolt-action rifle. This is a very strong action. It has very good properties for venting gas in the case of a ruptured cartridge, and while I do potentially risk cracking the stock, and if I keep shooting this, in theory, there is a potential for the whole stock to actually break and, you know, recoil coming back on that shot. Rifle can hit me and be unpleasant, but I don't really run the risk of this actually detonating because of one of these cartridges. That is not necessarily true for a self-loading firearm, though. If you have a gas system or a recoil system that is operating the gun, overpressure ammunition can be a very serious problem. So don't be one of those machine gun owners who is happy to spend $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 on a very cool historical machine gun and then get super cheap when they go to actually shoot it and buys the absolute cheapest, worst ammunition they can find, like Turkish 8mm. Hopefully you guys enjoyed the video. This is, of course, why I don't use the nicest rifles out there to do this testing. So we will be finding, I think, a new stock for this rifle if we're going to go on and use it anymore in testing like this. So anyway, it is thanks to the folks on Patreon that it's possible for me to pick up this ammo. We started this series with Ethiopian ammo provided by Century. I don't think after that Century is ever probably going to want to work with me again, which is fine. I've been providing, you know, I provide the other ammunition since for this sort of testing. So a big thanks to everyone on Patreon who makes that possible. Tune in again tomorrow for some more cool forgotten weapons.